Welcome to Enjoy the Music.tv. I'm your host, Stephen Alton. Today is March 14, 2014. And this episode features Michael Mercer of Audio 360. Woo! What an effect. I hope you guys like that guitar. Brought that in for you guys. And now, let me go ahead and bring in Mr. Mercer. Michael, how you doing?
Hey, I'm good. How you doing, brother?
Oh, phew. It's another hard, long day of work. Just right? Wrote my thing on Pono, which seems to be getting some really good responses.
Yeah, you know, he was very smart in getting, you know, the support of Beck and Norah Jones and, you know, a bunch of rock stars that, you know, the average everyday consumer that's not an audio geek could relate to. And I think that was probably the smartest move, because to be honest, Stephen, I did some consulting early on, as you know, with the project before it even had a name. And I never saw crowdfunding in their future. But, you know, the guys at Light Harmonic, you know, Gavin and Larry and the crew, you know, they proved great things can happen. And I just think it's awesome. My personal feelings about the player aside, you know, anything that brings a consciousness, especially to the masses, or at least to, you know, people who enjoy electronics, anything who imparts an idea of better sonics, helping you make a better connection to your music, I think is awesome.
Oh, I totally agree. And that's why with my article I just posted today, you know. So it looks like what we're going to do is we're going to cover a few topics. And the first one we're going to do is the upcoming, this is next weekend, give everyone the date and place of the Head-Fi event.
Sure. Next week, we're very excited. It's our Los Angeles Head-Fi meet, which is on March 22nd. And it's at the Westin South Coast Plaza. I'm reading it off here, which is on Anton Boulevard in Costa Mesa, Cali, which is Orange County, I believe. And we're totally pumped, Stephen. This has grown. Typically a meet, you know, a Head-Fi meet, they're all self-funded, you know, and we get the help of Head-Fi through promotions. And big shout out to the Head-Fi tribe.
Woo!
Love you guys.
Shout out to you guys.
And so this meet is literally going to be the second largest headphone event just behind Can Jam in the United States. It's blossomed into that. We've got Apogee, Astell&Kern, Odyssey, Bakun, EAR, Eddie Current, Headamp, Darren Fong Audio. He does this incredible software that it's called Out of Your Head. New Force, Shit Audio, Sennheiser, UE, Ultimate Ears. Y-Wires is going to finally be introducing their amazing headphone cable.
Nice.
Woo Audio. Via Electric, Amara, Sonic Studio Amara, and DNA.
So it's really,
you know,
it's
the DNA
really
stuff.
Blown up into this really great event.
It has, and I'm going to, you know, all the credit goes to Ethan and Warren. You know, they've done a hell of a job putting this thing together, and I'm just so excited. I'd love to share what I'm going to be bringing. I hate to geek out, but I'm really excited.
Oh, come on, come on. You posted some of it on...
That's what we love about meets, right? Because what sets a meet apart is it's not just... You know, typically there aren't this many vendors at a meet, you know? Usually it's just a handful of vendors and all user systems. So some people have actually been, you know, kind of hating on the fact that we have so many vendors. But, hey, the more the merrier, right?
Yeah, no, you know, we don't need haters. There's enough haters in the world.
Thank you. You know, let's be positive. It's all a positive thing. We're all going to have a great time. So, as you know, the great thing about a Head-Fi meet, a typical meet, is that, you know, members, we bring our systems. And what's cool about it is, like, maybe I want to hear the new Bakun product, and I can't afford to... buy it just to listen to it. You know, they may be low on review units. Who knows? And I can go listen to that from another user. And what we do is we list what we're bringing in the meet thread at Head-Fi so people can check off. Oh, if I want to listen to the Astell&Kern AK120, I'll go see Warren Chai, you know.
Wait, 120? Aren't we at the 240?
Which we reviewed at Audio 360, and I'm going to be picking up our review sample at the meet, so I'm so excited.
Woo! Mine should be here actually in a couple days, and I'm so looking forward to it.
Dude, we should tag team a review at Enjoy.
Oh, I would love that. Let me give everybody a quick picture of what that looks like. There it is, everyone. The AK 240. It's what everybody's been loving and waiting for. And
I, you know, at CES, I turned around and when I first heard it, and what was interesting is I took a picture of the first thing I listened to, which was Pink Floyd's Us and Them off Dark Side of the Moon. And I actually listened to a non-high-res file. And what was funny is my first share, you know, I think I pinged it out on Instagram or whatever. It said 44.1 16-bit, and, you know, this woman said, you know, why would you do that? And I said, well, actually, I need to know that it plays standard res, you know, in a brilliant way, too, because, to be honest, the 100 doesn't do a great job of that. It does amazing with high res, but it was never great with standard res, and the 240 is just a beast of amazing modern form meets function, and it feels great in your hand. It's substantial. And look, that's another thing people are hating on is the price. But as we said in our review at Audio 360, and we were the first ones to review it, was that this is what it costs, you know, people.
Yeah, I mean, to get all that technology, all that, if it was a big home unit, people would be like, oh, now imagine as an engineer, you have to take all this and shrink it into a portable, battery powered, that it operates efficiently. And what a lot of people don't realize, which I was just talking to PS Audio, one of their engineer designers, is you have all this noise going on, and you've got to make sure that everything, all your ground planes are right. If not, you know, the unit's going to be blah. $2,400, I'll take it.
Right, that's my cousin. You met Kenny. You know, you guys got along real well. He's picking one up. He owns a 120. You know, the first thing I thought, and I only got Warren and Michael got to do the review. So, like I said, I'm excited I get to pick it up and do a follow-up. But I only spent maybe 20 minutes with it. Mm-hmm. And I told Jimmy, you know, this was the first time, because I love those guys, but it was the first time I was considering just walking out with it and saying, all right, I'm not giving it back. I hijacked it.
Yoink, it's mine. Bye.
Text in the mail, buddies. Love you. But no, even the stand, you know, is exquisite.
Oh, I know. I mean, they've thought of and but then again, they have, what, how many years of experience now with the 100 and the 120? And
yeah, they worked. Look, people, I know, again, you know, a lot of people in the portable audio space, you know, this is a lot of money to a lot of people. But the truth is, like you said, look, as we talked about earlier, this is what it costs, the largest screen. It's Wi-Fi enabled. So for future, I love that in the future, you know, as soon as they get some deals signed for some licensing and whatever else they have to work out, you know, it could be HD tracks, you know, it could be B&W Society of Sound, you know, whatever it is, whatever stores, high-res stores, I love that you can shop on it now, you know, at home.
Oh, absolutely. One of the features I have to admit I love is that they've Wi-Fi enabled it, which I talk to them, so I can access my NAS. I mean, I don't have one here to do proof of the concept, but from what I've heard, this is something I want. And the other thing is, I have 4G LTE on my phone, which means I set that up as a Wi-Fi hotspot. My phone can access. You see where this is what I've actually been doing with something here, else. I can't get into it, but you know where I'm going here. See, you know this, is that basically I have Wi-Fi 4G LTE anywhere I go. I have my cloud servers, so as long as the device can access Wi-Fi, the rest just falls right into place, and I have unlimited storage, 128 gig. I've got terabytes and terabytes right underneath me right now.
Everywhere you go. In an amazing looking, really cool device. No,
exactly.
I mean,
way cool.
I knew you, you know. I just knew you'd have one, you know. I knew you. There were a couple people I knew would get it, and you were, you know, on top of the list.
But humble thanks.
No, very, very, very exciting. Very exciting piece. And so what I'm bringing to the Head-Fi meet, I'm really proud to say, is something that's been blowing me my doors off lately, which is the Cavalli Audio Liquid Gold differential solid state. And I will say this about that amp real quick, because I want to share what I'm bringing. But when I first heard the Liquid Gold, because I know the Lightning is tube. I don't know if it's hybrid, but I know it's tube. Mm-hmm. When I first heard the Liquid Gold, it blew me away enough. I said two things. One is it sounds like a hybrid to me, because I like to have, like in my two-channel system, for example, I like to have tubes in the preamp and solid state on the amp. And it sounded like a hybrid amp to me. It was just the fluidity, the continuousness, the texture. But running balanced, I have these amazing double helix cables, dual XLR going to my LCDX, Odyssey LCDX or LCDXC, and even the LCD3, which I still love. People forget what a great headphone that is. Yep. So I'm bringing that with all three of those and my Sennheiser HD800s.
Well,
and
the judging cool thing by is, what I see behind you,
yeah,
so, you have no shortage of gear.
I have no shortage of gear.
Nice Macintosh, by the way.
So you're going to love this. So I'm bringing the D100 because I use the D100 with the Liquid Gold because I run fully balanced from back to front.
That's the way to do it.
And the awesome thing about the Liquid Gold is that not only do you have the dual XLR out, but you also have a 4-pin XLR out. So, you can run two headphones. Nice. So, people, seem to be, a lot of the HD800 people, they are just HD800 people. And the Odyssey tribe is the Odyssey tribe. You and I were, I know you're different like me in that, we love them both. But I just think it's a great thing to put them side by side. And I'll tell you, the other thing I said to Alex Cavalli, so one was I thought it was a hybrid, and two was this is the only piece that made me think about my EAR HP4 by Tim DePavicini.
Nice.
And that's saying a lot because you know how much I love that.
since this is headphones, what I need to do, let me give everyone a quick picture of this. I've decided to go ahead and put on my headphones. These are the Steampunk LCD3s from right Odyssey. On. I used to think it was Audis, and I'm going to look ashamed. But yes, only well, over you, time did it. It's...
I did too. And in the beginning when they had the apostrophe, when it was, because that's how they got the people to pronounce Odyssey. But then they took out the apostrophe. But, we joke around, Audis, Odyssey, whatever. To me, nothing
as long as you know what you're talking about.
Nothing connects me to the music like it. I told Harry Pearson recently, by the way, he's doing well, everybody. Excellent. And the High Fidelity Report's doing well. Just wanted to put that in there. And where was I? Oh, so the Liquid Gold and the Odysseys together. I'm fully prepared to say this in a review, and I'm sure there's going to be some tongue lashing going on, but I don't care.
Some of us like tongue lashing, but that's right? That's a whole nother show. We're not doing that here.
So, you know what it reminded me of, Stephen?
What?
It reminded me of sitting in HP's place, because for those watching, that don't know our histories. I started work at Taz, and I worked my way up. I became Harry's setup man. It reminded me of sitting in room 3, which is the large room, as you know, listening to the NOLA Grand Reference loudspeaker system.
NOLA makes great speakers.
Driven by all ASR emitter amplifiers, all the big, big battery stuff, and the EAR Discmaster turntable with ASR Phonostage, and that system was beyond transcendent. I don't have the vernacular to describe accurately what that system did to me, but this system, my wife...
You're such a tease. I'm just saying, the tongue lashings, the telling us about Harry's room. I'm almost afraid of where the rest of this interview is going.
All right, I'll just say for the record, though, this is important for some people to know, is that when I told him that, he hung up on me.
Okay, so anyway, alrighty, kids.
So
calm down.
That, yeah, so that's so, the Macintosh D100, so it'll be a fully balanced system. And then I also figured that it's the first time I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna bring just a portable, for people who, don't hear what's going on in portable, You know, I'll have my Astell&Kerns with me, but I'm going to bring like an unsung hero that, you know, Jude, you know, Mancilla, founder of Head-Fi, turned me on to, the Sony PHA-1. Because as you know, they came out with the PHA-2, but we don't know if it's going to be available in the States. And
oh, the PHA- but the internet solves all that. I mean, that's the great thing with the internet is you just, you know, send them funds through PayPal and eventually you get whatever you want anyway.
But you know, for the average consumer is going to go on Amazon. Like I bought my PHA-1 from B&H Photo for $400. And it's one of the few portables aside of the Centrance Hi-Fi Mate that is, when I travel, I only need that because it's an iDevice DAC. You know, so it's great with my iDevices, and I get to the hotel room, and it's great with my Amara rig, my MacBook rig, and it's great for, you know, carrying around with you. And you know me, I mean, I pack like a little girl for audio shows, and it's true. But it's all I need, really, and you know, different headphones. So I'm thinking about bringing like a portable rig. And it's just going to be a really cool event. I really wish you could be there. I wish I could,
but it's the other coast. And
I know.
I'm only doing, what, 5 or 6 shows? And this whole TV studio, for those who don't know, I'm hoping to bring it to Expona. Just for the record. Anyway, I won't go there.
The one I'm going to miss. Well, maybe since, yeah, well, we'll see.
Yeah. Okay, so Audio 360.
Yes.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about what the hell are you guys doing there?
So audio360.org, as you know, we've been doing really well. You know, we officially launched it at Rocky Mountain Audio Fest last year. And, you know, we've got a great team of people, some of the most respected Head-Fi reviewers. It's myself, Warren Shi, and Michael Liang, a.k.a. Hi-Fi Guy 528 on YouTube. Mm. We're the principals, and the idea behind Audio 360 was our number one rule, our mantra was simply, we're not doing audio reviewing like anyone else. Everything is either multi-viewpoint, so it's at least 2 people, or it's more. It could go up to 4 or 5. I think we had 6 people on our Woo Audio WA7 review.
Yep, now that's a great idea. I'm trying to remember, there was a magazine, I don't think they're around anymore, they did that, but that was like...
Taz did it in the early days. That's where I got...
Taz did it early days. Another magazine, I forget who as well did it. But it's a great concept as long as everyone can get their stuff together in a timely manner. The logistics, just so the viewers know, it's not as easy as you think.
And it isn't, and thank you, God, for Google Docs, because what's great is, you know, we have the Google Drive, and we can be all in there working, and we have the chat going, so we're actually like, it does happen conversationally, and we have the round tables too, which, you know, I got that idea from Taz, and it's interesting, because Warren and I, you know, my partner, my dear friend, you know, he doesn't know that Taz did that stuff, but you know, we come to these ideas together, and I'll say to him, you know, Taz did this, right? Harry did this. And it's really interesting that he wants to do something, and when I tell him, you know, Harry did it before. So, admittedly, we're doing them in a much fresher way, simply because it's the present. But Harry actually really, really digs what we're doing, and that means a lot to me. And the response has been just amazing from the personal audio community. That's our focus, I should say. But we called it Audio 360 for a reason, and that's because we are going to eventually cover stereo gear too. But we're just all very excited about personal audio. It's a new frontier. And so I just wanted to, you know, I was very proud. We were very fortunate and blessed to be the first website to review the AK240. You know, we have some very interesting stuff coming up. We just published a review of the SPL Labs Phonitor 2, mm-hmm. which, as you know, the one is legendary, the first one. And I spent limited time with it, but it was Michael and Kevin that did the full review. But I can see why Michael Liang is going to change it to his reference amplifier over his beloved Lehman Audio, which we reviewed together and I love. And you, I know you know them very well.
Oh, I actually got, for those who don't know Lehman Audio, when I was online, this is again, we're going back to the online stuff, is that I was on CompuServe and somebody in Germany said you have to hear their stuff. And the owner, Norbert Lehman, now we're going back, God, 15 years ago, he never even made a unit with 120 volt. He was still kind of undergroundish, or at least, so he made 120 volt for me of their cube, which is a phono stage, sent it to me, I listened to it, and my jaw went for the price. And the rest, as they say, is history.
And they, I didn't know this, but because Michael and I reviewed their linear USB, which is, you know, basically like a follow-up to the Cube headphone amp.
Well, no, the Cube was a phono stage, but the other two, they had the headphone.
Yeah, they did a headphone amp, too.
Yep, that's right. Sorry.
So what Michael told me is, and this tells you something about it, Sennheiser trusted it enough that when, I didn't know this, when they introduced the HD800, they used the Cube, the Lehman Audio Cubes.
Yep.
So anyway, Michael is, of course, he's keeping his beloved Lehman, you know, as am I, but he's changing to the Phonator for his reference amp, and he's got so much love for the Lehman that that says a lot about it. We're going to be New Force. I have here their foray into in-ears, the Primo 8s. And as you know, I'm not a big IEM guy. I own my JH Audio, JH13 Freak Phases. I really don't need anything else. But I won't say that these surpass them by any means, and I don't believe in really comparing products that are so that are different in philosophy.
Yes.
But I want to say this about the Primo 8, which is why I decided to review it. Not only did we go to meet the guys at New Force, and they're a great bunch of guys, but the minute I put it in my ear, I have not heard mid-range be that silky, and the bottom end was just so extended in a standard, in a universal IEM.
Nice, yeah.
I've never, you know, I don't know if you, the Cardis are great, the 5813s, they're airy.
Yep, I've had various universal IEMs, and while I love them, I admit the JH Audio, Ultimate Ears, etc., I personally prefer IEMs over headphones, but it is a personal preference. Neither is right nor wrong. It just simply is.
Yeah.
No, so anyway, you were talking about some ideas in an article you've done and some things you wanted to bounce off me.
So recently, my most recent column for the High Fidelity Report was called Music and Sound Lifts Me Up. And I took a big chance in this article, and, you know, writing for you, you know, I pour my heart into everything that I do. But I took a big chance there because it was really personal. You know, I got sick, as you know, after CES, and what sucked was, you know, not only that did I get really, really sick, but you know, and others that are good friends of mine know, I don't sit still very well. And CES was amazing. You know, the response for 360 was amazing. I had such a good time, despite, you know, not seeing a lot of people because a lot of people weren't there that I missed.
Yeah, between the weather. And, plus, CES is so huge. If you've never been to CES, let me tell you. Think of, I don't even know. Think of a large college. The only way to relate is maybe a large college campus. And you've got to run through this campus from end to end. It's just insane.
It is insane. And, you know, I'm not a huge fan. I like, you know, the Rocky Mountain Audio Fests and, you know, the Newports and the Exponas better, just because it's more of a community vibe. But now, even this year, I had to go to the zoo, you know, since we're in high end. Yeah, I had to go to the
You lose a half hour each way just because of the shuttle. Then you have to wait in the line. So there goes 3 hours of your life in transportation alone. Right?
Insane. And I had to be there for two whole days because, you know, I'm so focused on personal audio these days that I had to go there and check stuff out. And the guys at Sennheiser and, you know, Monster, and which they're doing great stuff, by the way.
But it's just amazing how much time you lose doing that.
Oh, it's ridiculous. So anyway, I got really sick after CES this year. And the only way I could get better was to literally do nothing, you know? So not being able to live without my music, but I also couldn't get back into the Sonic Satori Personal Audio Lab. I couldn't get back to this wonderful stuff.
Well, last time we interviewed you, you were living out of boxes.
Yeah, and that too, you know? So I still was half living out of boxes when this hit. And so what I did is, you know, right when it hit and I went to see the doc and I found out what it was, I got what I call, I got together what I called my audio survival kit, because I knew I wasn't going to be able to come back here. It was just various headphone amps, you know, the one that I pulled out to plug into my reference system was a Burson conductor, and various things. And the only things I could do was watch movies, and listen to music. And I realized during this whole experience, you know, I've experienced the healing power of music before.
Nice.
But I really realized, and I had to admit this, that, you know, because we're so, this is what we do, this is our life. And not only did I realize what a blessing it is and that I was probably taking it for granted a little bit, but I realized that my music, which I love so much, I wasn't really listening all that much for pure pleasure, you know, except for in the car. And at my boys' houses, you know, or visiting friends.
Oh, yeah,
friends,
you know? Beware the burnout syndrome. I've had two bouts of that now over the years.
So, and you can relate to this. And I felt like I, and also I couldn't write, Stephen, which, as you know.
It's burnout. Everyone gets it that I know of.
I was paralyzed. And so, yeah, Stephen Stone wrote me and said, I told you, you get sick. But, you know, it got really bad. It was a five-week ordeal. And
saw your way through it. And
I did.
You've got some ideas. You wrote this recent article. You poured your heart and soul into it. Now that you're well, it's all good. So tell everyone about this recent article that you just posted.
So it's called, Music and Sound Lifts Me Up. And it's all about that experience. And the reason I say I took a chance is just very personal. And my editor, you know, Joseph Weiss, really loved it. But he knows me. And, like, you know me. And certain people that I knew were going to be reading it know me. But it's the first time in a long time that I was, like, freaked out about it. Because I knew that there were a lot of my readers, they've never met me. Or there'd be readers that haven't read me before.
Right.
Don't know
and so
me.
You poured your heart and soul into this. And what's the basic... What do you want people to basically get out of that article?
Just that as a confessed music addict and audio reviewer, that I experience, you know, nothing short of an awakening, not only in terms of, you know, how blessed I am to do this, and also, you know, I did work my ass off for 20 years to be in this position, but, you know, that I really, what I want them to pull away from it is that a couple of things, you know, not there are two different schools of people I find a lot, and I talk to a lot of people about this, people that listen to the music for the gear, or people that listen to the gear strictly as a vehicle to the music, and I fall into the latter category, as I know you do too. And so I just, you know, reaffirmed commitment on my part as an audio reviewer to keep pouring my heart and soul into everything that I do, and to, kind of reaffirm my responsibility in trying to inform people and share the enthusiasm and not waste time. You know, I don't do this anyway, but, you know, I got sick and tired at one point of reading other reviewers' opinions on other reviewers and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, you know, it's like...
I do, which is also why in my recent thing about Pono, it's like, look, it's not about me. It's not about you. This is a move. What they're trying to do is, what I can tell, is a movement to at least make the public aware that there is high fidelity files out there. They're not using the word audiophile too much. They're not. They're avoiding certain other things I don't want to get into. But the point being is they're looking to reach the mainstream. He also has his crowd, we'll call it, which is what? Beck and a bunch of other famous musicians.
Yeah, Nora Jones and Sting and, yeah, like...
Yeah, these people have never heard. Who's Nora Jones? Who's Sting? Didn't Sting, like, what was that band called? The Cops or the...
Yeah, the Cops.
Oh, the Police. Oh, that's it. That's right. But imagine the power.
Again, I'm not hating on Sting, but I do want to say, with regards to Sting, that Ozzy Osbourne had the best line. It was unfortunate when he wasn't in the best... state, you know, I just saw the recent documentary about, you know, what they were going through during the Osbournes reality show. But he said something at the end of the second or third season that had me in stitches. And, you know, it's when he was, you know, dealing with his addictions and stuff, and he really couldn't move. And the guy asked him, you know, you know, I think he asked him, is there anything you regret or something to that effect? And Ozzy Osbourne looks right in the camera and says, you know, it could be worse. I could be Sting.
Oh, man. Ouch.
So, I mean, he's just known to be a pain in the neck. But, you know, he's a brilliant artist. You know, you got to separate the art from
the
artist.
Well, that's the whole thing. I mean, in a sense,
The message is hugely important. And look, it's Neil Young. You know, he wasn't going to mess around.
Right, exactly. And a lot of us are artists or musicians or studio guys. I mean, there are audiophiles or high-end audio people who aren't. Maybe they want to be or whatnot. But in some ways, we are artists, or at least we're huge art. We appreciate art.
Absolutely.
I was about to start making up my own word, art appreciationers.
Yeah. Hey, dude, I like that. You know, you should hashtag that.
Oh, God, no. So what else before we wrap this up, my friend?
Sure. What I wanted to say is that article gave me an idea for something to write for you at Enjoy the Music, which is so you call it your memo, right? Your mission statement last year?
Yes, that's right. For those not familiar, there is a Enjoy the Music memo to the industry, which I poured my heart and soul into, I admit. And I thought either I'm going to get flamed down and kicked out of this hobby club, or it'd work, and I was willing to take the chance. So what you got? Bring it.
So I was going to say that article, I want to give you props because you sent that to me before you published it, if you remember.
Yes.
And it moved
me. So I wouldn't embarrass myself too much.
Knowing you, and look, you and I make no apologies for enthusiasm, and, you know, it's one of the reasons I love you. So that article has informed a lot of the stuff I've done since in terms of not holding back. So what I have is I really want to dive into, and not in a negative way, how audiophile culture has split itself off so steeply from consumer level culture. And we're really, forget what, like you say, it's not about you or me. Forget about what we think about that. But we're not serving the user. And most importantly, we're not serving the potential user.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, by being elitist and, you know, by pointing out the faults in people's, you know, crowdfunding campaigns.
Wait a minute. You mean the audiophiles can nitpick?
Just a little.
I'm crushing your head.
I'd like to dive into, instead of just pointing out the negatives, some solutions. I started doing this in my What is the Future of the High-End series for PFO, but I want to dig more deeply into this because I realized that I have some personal experience in it. This hi-fi dealer here in Santa Rosa, Mark Silver at Soundscape, you know, he's a truly old school shop. I mean, it's a stereo shop. You know, he's got tube testers. And, you know, we came up with some new ideas at his store. And I've visited him recently, and he told me that he, like, lost all the DJ business when we left, me and my friend Michael, and, you know, lost, you know, the headphone. He lost a certain segment, and I told him, like, you don't need me to keep that up. You know, just be aware of all I figured out then was that there were a lot of DJs in Santa Rosa. They go down to the Bay Area, and there was a lot of house DJs.
Well, Ray Dolby said, you know, that people are like, and he is a genius, but he's so humble. He said, it's just that I was aware of my environment and what's going on and looking around, and that's boom. And now we all benefited from Ray Dolby, Dolby Digital, and all his creations. Thank you.
I have to tell you about Pete Davey, and I ended up, like, hanging out with the whole Dolby crowd, like, crew by accident at CES, this restaurant. And there were so many of them, and they were all so happy. And you can tell that, you know, no matter how big they've gotten, and, you know, I'm sure they're way bigger than even the people in the restaurant. We couldn't believe, though, they wouldn't stop coming. We were like, how big is the team that's here? But yeah, he left an indelible mark. So what I want to do is I want to provide some solutions, you know, like I did for Mark, but ones that I have experience with. And I really want to I want to talk to the dealers, too, because, you know, at the Los Angeles and Orange County Audio Society Gala last year, a dealer walked up to me, Stephen. And so I want to write about this and what I could say to that dealer if I had more time.
Yeah.
He actually said to me, if you can believe it, I just want to tell you what he said because you won't believe it. He said, he came up to me and he was angry with me. Now, this was a friend of mine. And he said, I don't understand how you're supporting all these personal audio companies. And I was like, hi, how are you? How's the wife, you know? I said, what are you talking about? What do you mean support? He's like, they all sell their stuff on Amazon. And I'm like, I won't say his name, you know, but I said, it's the biggest retailer on the planet.
Oh, yeah. And they just raised to $99 there. You don't want to know how many Amazon boxes we have in the house.
Right. You turned me on to Prime. And you know what he said to me after that?
Why?
So he kind of interrupted me, and I was going into the fact of why, dude, some of the high-end companies he sells, I'm sure, on Amazon. And he said, you know, if they'd stop giving to Amazon and doing business with Amazon, you know, the dealers could feel more supported. And my quick response to him was, you know, it's not about just the gear. You have to sell you, your knowledge. Why should someone go to you instead of Amazon? Why should someone go to you instead of trusting that user review? So I want to, for Enjoy the Music, I want to come up with some solutions that I really can put my heart and soul behind and that I know will work and, you know, could work. And so I think that's a part of what I wanted to say on my last piece that kind of laid the foundation for me taking on a new leaf. And I've never been a negative guy, as you know, in my pieces, but, you know, now and then I struck back, if you will, and I'm not going to even do that anymore because, you know, I want to help
Why?
Keep growing
keep
this
positive.
Thing.
Well, yeah. That sounds like a good place to wrap this up. Michael, thank you so very, very much for taking the time and being with us. I really do appreciate it.
Steven, love you, man. It's always a blast. I look forward to the next one. And yeah, if anyone's in the LA area, LA Head-Fi Meet, March 22nd, it's next Saturday. It's going to be a blast.
Excellent. Thanks again, and talk to you soon.
Peace.
Peace, brother. So, there we are, Michael Mercer. I'd like to thank him. And a lot of people are probably wondering, well, who am I? I am Stephen Rochlin, editor, creative director of enjoythemusic.com. And in the end, what really matters is that you enjoy the music. Be well, everyone.